This week on Angler West TV, we're in Southern California with Hall of Fame bass angler and lure designer Bill Siemantel fishing Diamond Valley Lake. Barely a decade old, Diamond Valley has quickly earned a reputation as one of California's best bass fisheries, a perfect place for Bill to throw his signature swim baits. But today's clear and calm water conditions say no to big baits. Today, you will get a first-hand look at how Bill Siemantel breaks down a lake with finesse tactics as he puts together a quality bag of bass on a very tough day on Diamond Valley Lake.
Well, we definitely figured out the bite today.
I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television.
We've been on water for an hour and a half. Started out with some big baits off some outside points, threw some finesse back in some cuts, and we came around a corner and down this bank right here. I've seen probably 15 or 20 fish in the 2 to 4 pound range, some solid fish. We have more fish sitting outside of them in that 15 to 20 foot range. Man, I have scaled down back, and if you're throwing reaction baits, like I said, I was here last week, water was dirtier. You're throwing reaction baits and you're getting fish following and hitting, it's a no-brainer. Man, I'm throwing reaction baits. Nothing's following it. I'm throwing dart heads up on these fish. I'm throwing jigs up on the fish. They see the bait and they actually swim away. So when they're telling you something, turn around and listen to them. I'm gonna put a split shot on, put some Pro-Cure on my bait, go super finesse. And this is old school. I'm gonna throw a finesse up on the bank and drag it right out. They're right on the color change. And hopefully get a couple of these fish. And like I said, we've only been here for an hour and a half, so if we can get a pattern established now, then we can continue this pattern all day long. Trying to catch the first fish is the key. Oh, look at that. Second cast, split shot, threw it up on the bank. I'm using super light line. I got 5 pound test on. Went with a little teeny hand-poured sluggo. And this fish came up and ate it, so I mean, this is the situation. I mean, just a great little tournament fish. Absolutely just great little fun fish. And never even really felt the bite. It just kind of swam off it with it real slow. So this is the thing. If I'm out here trying to figure out a bite, come here, little sweetie. Little play. Those Gamagatsu hooks are sharper than heck. Pretty little fish, split shotting, talking about old school. Great little fish. These are some of the fish I've seen up on this bank. So here's something to learn right here. Look at that. This is a key thing to learn right here. Paying attention. Now, I came down this bank. I saw quite a few bass sitting up on the bank and down off this break. If I didn't take the time to sit there, and you know, you guys weren't in the boat with me, but I got 35 plano boxes in here with every lure you can imagine. Use them. You know, they're not gonna do any good sitting in your boat if you don't use them. So, I mean, I went through everything and went back down to an old little hand pour and trying to figure out if they're keying in on a little teeny bait fish out here, a little smelt, and put a little Pro-Cure on it, threw it out on the bank. And like I said, I also know that it's a really touchy bite because it wasn't one of these dunk and swim off with it. I never even felt the hit, and I saw my line move just a little bit and just sit there, and I set the hook. So it's gonna be a tough bite today, but you catch 5 or 6 fish like that, it'll turn out to be a good day real quick.
Bill Siemantel is known for having great success with big baits, but today on Diamond Valley Lake, those big baits are staying on the deck.
A lot of people are thinking, man, Bill only throws big baits. I tell you what, I'm a fisherman like you, and the key on understanding big baits, and here's the trick for anybody starting out or guys who've been doing it for years, it's learning how quick not to use them. If you get on the water and you say, I'm just gonna throw a swim bait all day long, and you're coming out on clear water and you're throwing a swim bait, and you go for 4 or 5 hours and you see nothing, you're doing something wrong. First of all, you're throwing the wrong bait. Oh, nice little fish. That didn't take long. Now I could do this all day long. Ooh, nice little, oh, great little fish. Here he comes, he's gonna jump right here. Nice little fish. Take your time, open water, light line. Do a little back reeling and you should get most of your fish in. Oh, he ate it. I had to cut that hook off in that fish, but this is a really simple rig to tie and use. I'm going to use a little size 2 Gamagatsu thin wire worm hook, but it's made by RoboWorm. It's a rebarb. The hooks are just phenomenal that RoboWorm does with this little rebarb on it, because you can put small plastics on it. And this little teeny plastic right here, that little rebar, that right there is money. That keeps your bait from sliding down the hook. Cut the tag off. And this is kind of like a modified Carolina rig. What I'm using, them Carolina Keeper, clear. I always use clear in clear water. And all you do is you push it with your pliers, you squeeze it, and it opens up that little space, and you adjust your length. So you got your length here, and I'm using a little teeny Mojo sinker. And what I'm gonna do is, I got some old worms. You know, you could use little Sankos. I've got some hand-poured Sluggos. Little baits, you know. Finesse. RoboWorm also has some really nice little teeny plastics. But it seems like they want this little teeny bait fish here. And all I'm doing, Texas rig it, come down kind of straight, because it's a straight shank hook. Pull it through. Catch it on that rebar, rotate your hook around and measure where you need to put that hook in and set it up straight. And remember, you're using that hook basically as a keel. And then from there, we're putting on a little Pro-Cure. Got enough salt on the bait. I'm just gonna put a little dab of Pro-Cure on it, down the bait. See my lure? That's what I'm trying to mimic right there. Came out of that fish I just caught. Might have regurgitated it. You see him throwing up bait like that, definitely I'm gonna start matching the hatch. The cool thing about it is understanding angles, boat angles. You got a point running out into the water. You want fish to kind of force that bait up into something to eat it. You want those funnels. So with the split shot I'm throwing over this point, I'm gonna bring it up this side. Fish have an opportunity to eat it against that side of the point. As I crest the point, fish have opportunity to eat all the way around the front of it. And then as I bring it down this side, they have it on this, you know, on the back end. So with one cast, if you set up good boat control and you drag your bait right, swim bait, Carolina rig, jig, you name it, you're going to put yourself in a position to have multiple strikes in one cast. That's where the guys excel. The guys on the tournament trail and fish regularly understanding the lanes on how to fish a bait, those are the ones that catch more fish more often. You know how some guys catch more fish than the others and all this stuff? It's truly paying attention. Now, the key on this that caught this fish, as I'm dragging, what happens is I use just, you know, I'm using 5 pound test max, super light line, clear water, little baits, but the key here, look at that, pretty little fish. The key here is I'm dragging it. My sinker's just heavy enough, so if I'm going real slow, I'm gonna feel these rocks. When you feel your bait go, dunk, 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 and you feel it going through the rocks, slow down. That is where you're in the right spot. If you're dragging and you don't feel nothing, either you're fishing too fast or you're in mud. So when you pull it and you feel that kind of gravelly dunk, 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 against your lead, you gotta remember 18 to 20 inches behind your sinker, your bait's coming up to that rock pile or that brush line or the gravel. Slow it down. I slowed it down, dunk, ate the bait and swam off. So doing something like this, could have been a pound and a half fish, could have been a 15 pounder. The key was I was fishing the right structure, using the right technique, and paying attention when I felt the the funnel, that good area where they're gonna eat against, and catch fish like this all day long. There's another fish.
Welcome back to Diamond Valley
Lake.
I'm Justin Wolf. Calm, clear water conditions has Bill Siemantel showing us his bag of finesse fishing tricks that work like a charm on tough days like this.
Days like this, when you think it's super tough, put a split shot on, and these are the days you take a kid fishing.
While Bill has been able to catch deeper fish on a split shot, the shallow fish we see require a more refined finesse fishing technique.
The buck's up close, female sitting out, just at color change. There's another fish down here on a bed or getting ready to sit on a bed. So look at this buck right here. He's just cruising. Some of these are the hardest fish to catch. They just keep moving. They're not locked on anything. This buck right here is gonna turn around and go out there and get that female that's about 4 pounds sitting right here in front of us and start trying to push her in when that water warms up a little bit more. This is very unusual for me. The few times I've been to this lake, usually by 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning, you start getting some wind. And this place is just absolutely, there's not a breath of air, completely flat calm. You see fish out here suspended in open water about 6 foot under the surface, and they're just cruising. If you throw anything to them, man, they're out of here. So definitely need something to help this bite. We need either wind coming up, a mud line, something needs to happen, a little overcast with the clouds. So we've seen some good fish down this bank. Might have to change up and maybe put on a small Senko or something and fly line it and try to drift it out over some of these fish and see if they'll go. These are the days you run into. This is actually a good day. Sometimes you want to see a guy catch 100 fish in a row. This is the stuff you need to see to watch a guy keep changing over and over and figuring these fish out. We know we could still go out and catch them on a split shot, but let me try to put a Senko on or something and fly line it around here and see if we can get something to go. Got him. Oh, nice fish. This is what I'm talking about, you know. You come out here and you try different techniques. You cover the water column. They're out here suspended in open water and they don't want to play. So when I get this fish in, everybody wants to kind of know some of the secret stuff I do. I want to show you a thing I've been doing for absolutely a long time. And this actual hook and jig I'm showing you, I've had about 15 years. But this is a stupid technique when it gets super tough. Look at this nice, nice fat fish. Look at that fish right there. Now I'll show you something. Look inside that mouth. See a little jig? About 15 years ago, I was messing with drop shot, well, not drop shot, but little teeny bait hooks. And I'll show you what I put on that little thing. But this is a real finessey little thing, but I mean, what a beautiful, that's a beautiful little bass right there. Get her back in. Look at that. Now here's the trick. About 15 years ago, I used to take an old little Gamagatsu hook, smash a lead weight on it, and then put a 3DI on top of it. Pro soft bait, glue it, miniature jig. Come over here, you take any type of bait you want, but sometimes when they get really touchy, take a Senko, nose hook it. That's all you have to do. Bring right through there. What happens when you're shaking it on the bottom, when it falls down, it looks like something trying to eat like an egg or something off the bottom. You'd be surprised how many times this will convert fish that will not touch anything else. That's a little secret out of my box I've used for 15 years to catch fish. High sun, no wind, super clear water, light line, little teeny miniature bait like that, and fish it real slow. I have a silly little fish. Oh, that's a good fish too. Coming down this bank, I put this little bait on. I've only thrown it about three or four times. The first time I threw out and it was sinking to the bottom, and I had this nice fish hit it. And as I was coming down the bank, we got 15 to 20 foot visibility in this rock quarry. And I see a little buck sitting up there in the shadow of a rock. And I just threw this little bait over there. And first cast, I threw it in there, it went down on it and ate it. Could be getting ready to spawn on the next moon phase. Definitely see some big females out here in suspended water, but you know, in open water. But like I said, we went through this area once and got a few hits. Turned around, put on a real nice Finesse bait. Catch some great fish on this little teeny jig.
Big bait guru Bill Siemantel knows when to go small, and today he has an ultra-small jig working on shallow fish. But with patience, that same ultralight rig can convert deeper fish as well.
I come across this little rock bluff right here, and I'm holding in 21 foot of water, and I can see the color change. It's just dark. Fired out the little bait, let it go to the bottom. It took forever. It gets to the bottom, I'm letting it sit there, and the fish swims off. It seems like a better fish. So that means these bigger females are out here staging at the color change in 20 foot of water, and you just need a really Finesse bait. And I tell you one thing, when you're throwing a bait that's less than, you know, 1/32 of an ounce on a little Senko and on a 5-pound test string, it takes forever to get to the bottom. But I tell you one thing, when it does, it's definitely worth it. And you have nothing else to worry about on days like this when it's flat calm. Oh, nice, nice fat fish. That's a great fish. You wanna jump a little bit more? That's a good bass right there. Look at that. Look at this right here. Little thing came up, pinned it right in the top of the lip. Well, you know what we did is we actually went back in a big rock quarry about an hour ago, and we got a couple fish off break lines. We saw some up tight. Come to another part of the lake, we're still trying to continue finding these patterns on really tough tough days. No wind, flat, calm, and clear. I mean, you can't have anything tougher than this. Oh, that's a, geez Louise. That, my friend, is a good fish. Throwing a dart hit up down these banks, we, I don't know, he might jump underneath the other side of the boat. Oh, look at that. Started coming down this big dam, and we threw out the light stuff. We saw a bunch of fish out there suspended. And watch this fish come up and jump. This is a good fish right here. Look at her. Here she comes. Oh. So I started seeing a lot of suspended fish, so I backed off, and I just picked up a dart head, you know, put a little plastic worm on it, put a little RoboWorm FX sculpin, and threw up on the bank, and I'm just shaking it down the rocks, you know, just bringing it down the rocks, and this fish just came up and smoked it. This is a good quality fish right here on a dart head. So here's another part of the puzzle. We got small little Finesse baits going, we got split shot going, now we got some dart head fish. that right there. That right there. Look at that fish right there. Little dart head right there, little dart head plastic. But look at that fish. That's a pretty, pretty fish right there. So here's the deal. It's tough. It's tough fishing. But you got to pay attention. And right now in flat, calm conditions, no wind, super clear water, we found four or five different techniques. And we've been on the water for about 4.5, 5 hours. So you continue moving around, watch the fish, see where they're positioned. If you don't see them up tight in clear water, move out, find them on your graph, and fish for them. And the tougher it is, start downsizing. Start putting on the little stuff and taking your time and working it over each rock, and you're gonna start picking up fish. There's a hit. There we go. Oh, that's a nice fish right there. About 20, 30 minutes ago, we were throwing dart heads. Ooh, nice fish off the dam. And I noticed a couple of these nice little 45 degree banks coming over here on the northwest corner of the lake. So I came out, and it's kind of a shallow point. So I got in about 15 foot of water, and I just fired a dart head out as far as I could. And I was just dragging it across the bottom. And I cut feeling like little pea gravel rock, and I think I stuck it into a stick, shaking it through a stick, and I was just letting it sit there. And this fish just come up and ate it. Oh, look at this. Nice fish. Oh. Look at that. Oh, gosh. Another pretty, pretty fish on a dart head. Now, as that sun's getting higher, I'm thinking about fishing a little bit deeper, especially on these like little tapering points. I want to get out there past that 15 foot mark. And here's another prime example. I think with split shotting, dart heading, and even maybe throwing out a little stick bait or something with still no wind, I think I could have caught this fish on any three of those lures. But the dart head was a little bit better because it got me to the bottom a lot quicker in that 20 foot zone. Another pretty fish, look at that.